Chris, Sunday morning, the first Sunday of Lent. I guess that's what happens when Easter's early, we get colder Sundays of Lent. We shall not live by bread alone, but every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. Our opening hymn is in your large blue books, 175, verses 1, 2, and 5. Submission to your spirit, that as you know our weakness, so we may know your power to save, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Please be seated and listen to the word of God.
Thank you.
taken from Romans chapter 5, beginning at the 12th verse. Therefore, just as sin came into the world through one man, and death came through sin, and so death spread to all because all have sinned. Sin was indeed in the world before the law, but sin is not reckoned when there is no law. Yet death exercised dominion from Adam to Moses, even over those whose sins were not like the transgression of Adam, who was the type of the one who was to come. But the free gift is not like the trespass, for if the many died through the one man's trespass, much more surely of the grace of God, and the free gift is the grace of the one man, Jesus Christ. Abounded for the many, and the free gift is not like the effect of the one man's sin. The judgment following one's trespass brought condemnation, but the free gift following many trespasses brings justification. Because of a man's trespass, death exercised dominion through that one. Much more surely will those who receive the abundance of grace and the free gift of righteousness exercise dominion in life through the one man, Jesus Christ. Therefore, just as one man's trespass led to condemnation for all, so one man's act of righteousness leads to justification and life for all. For just as by the one man's disobedience, the many were made sinners, so by the one man's obedience, the many will be made righteous. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our graduate hymn is 628, verses 1 and 2 of the Gospel. Son of God, command these stones to become loaves of bread. But he answered, It is written, one does not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God. And the devil took him to the holy city and placed him on a pinnacle of the temple, saying to him, If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down, for it is written, He will command his angels concerning you. And on their hands they will bear you up, so that you will not dash your foot against a stone. Jesus said to him, Again it is written, Do not put the Lord your God to the test. Again the devil took him to a very high mountain, and showed him all the kingdoms of the world, and their splendor. And he said to them, All these I will give you, if you will fall down and worship me. Jesus said to him, Away with you, Satan. For it is written, Worship the Lord your God and serve only him. Then the devil left him, and suddenly angels came and waited on him. The word of the Lord.
Grace to you, Lord Jesus Christ. 628, verse 3 and 7. Thank you.
confess our faith as we say.
We believe in one God, the Father of all almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten not made, come one being with the Father, through whom all things were made, for us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate of the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified and overcomes our life. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory, judge us the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father, who with the Father and Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He is spoken through the cross. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Let the words of my mouth and meditation of all our hearts be totally acceptable to you, our Lord and our Redeemer. Amen.
Please be seated.
The wilderness challenge then and now. This morning's gospel is very familiar to us as we enter into Lent, this being the first Sunday in Lent. And we hear of Jesus being tempted three times. He fasted. He was to be put on top of a pinnacle. And he was taken to the top of a mountain. What we should understand first and foremost is the intricacies of language. The simple word of tempt, of temptation. We go back to the original Greek word, perizein. But in English, we take the word tempt to enticing us to do something that is wrong. We should not eat this, or we shouldn't hang out with those people, or we shouldn't do this activity because it's wrong. However, the original Greek word, perizein, had a very different meaning, and it meant to test. The Old Testament readings give us one of those more vivid examples of testing when Abraham narrowly escaped sacrificing his only son Isaac. Jesus, God, was testing Abraham clearly to see Abraham's loyalty. Jesus went into the wilderness alone. The area that he went into was between Jerusalem and the Dead Sea. And there's a Old Testament scholar, George Adam Smith, who traveled extensively back in his day. And he talks about this area of wilderness that Jesus would have went into, being of yellow sand, crumbling limestone, rock ridges running in all directions. Hills were like dust heaps, blistered limestone, bare jagged rocks. This is where Jesus went in to be alone. He needed to sort out what God, his Father, was asking of him. He needed to get it straight. I remember when I was just starting out in industry as a young apprentice and knew virtually nothing about life much at all and less about my trade. And my mentor, his name was Sandy McDonald. He was very old at the time, I think about 53 or 4. But you got to remember, like, I was 18 and a half. So he was very old. But he said to me, he said, I'm going to give you, he gave me all kinds of wisdom that I still use today. But one of the sayings, he said, I'm in a hurry, I must stop and think. Boy, that got me out of a lot of trouble over my life, and still does. I'm in a hurry to respond to somebody's criticism. Stop and think.
I come up a little differently. There was a gentleman that I did his funeral for. Some may know who the person is, Walter Kingston. And I worked with him at the refinery, and he was my first manager. And he did a similar thing. He says, when you get approached by somebody that's upset, take a break from that emotional moment and then come back to it. And your response will be different. Well, Jesus has gone out into the wilderness. He's got a lot of conflicting things I can only think of from my perspective. Because we know that he basically grew up in a normal carpenter's home. The only little snippet we get is when he was just a young lad and he laid over after the Passover and they found him in the temple, and he was rather amazing in what we know of that experience. But we hear nothing about Jesus at all until he turns 30 and he comes to be baptized by his cousin, John the Baptist. But you would understand that he would have a lot of internal things going on about timing and whatnot, and about his purpose on earth. And then he goes to the baptism, and John the Baptist baptizes him, and we know that exchange that happened. And then he hears his father say, "You are my son, the beloved. With you I am well pleased." All these things are happening, and he is yet to start his ministry, his purpose. He goes out to the desert to sort that out. How about you and I? Do we need times in our life to sort things out? I think that's part of why I was so fascinated about what the Camino did for me, just doing the thing 5 years ago, well, 6 years ago almost now, to make me want to go back and do that experience fully. To be alone with your thoughts. We know, as I've shared on the Camino, you're not totally alone. But you are kind of, because the rest of the world has kind of gone in the background. And you are walking down many dirt roads and paths, you and the Spirit. Another thing that I get out of this gospel reading this morning is the temptation. I don't think they're that literal, because there's no mountain high enough on these plains, this wilderness, that he would be able to see the whole kingdom. But I think what it is representative of is the inner struggle. And it was only a sampling of the inner struggle that Jesus was going to have. Because we know that in Caesarea Philippi, Peter tried to dissuade Jesus from going to the cross. And Jesus says, "Get behind me, Satan." He would later say to his disciples, and we get in Luke, "You are those who have stood by me in my trials," which would speak to the fact that he had many temptations. And in the Gethsemane capture in Luke, Jesus himself says, "Father, if you are willing, take this cup from me, yet my will, not let yours be done." We would like to think at this stage in our lives as Christians, we'd be beyond the power of temptation. And I remember very vividly the first time I sat with Reverend Hugh Walker in St. Joseph's facility in Thunder Bay. And Reverend Hugh Walker counseled everybody, many people with addictions, all kinds of addictions. We all have addictions. I like to eat too much, which is very difficult. Or eat the wrong things, I guess. But Hugh Walker gave me an image that I'll never forget. And he says, whether you call Satan, the devil, an evil force, or whatever causes you to be addicted to something, and it could be drugs, it could be alcohol, it could be my problem, whatever one of my problems. I'm not going to tell you all. But he said, it's the most patient force. It'll sit there on your shoulder for an hour, a day, a week, a month, years, many years. You open the door a crack and it's got you. This Lenten season, we are looking at this book called Let Me Go There by Paula Gooder. And I'm call to one, we're going to sit and chat about what we are stirred with by what we read. The author says Lent is a season that invites us to step into the wilderness with all its ambiguity. It challenges our courage and our vulnerabilities. It's a time for us to slow down in Lent, like the Camino allows you to slow down really, really. What the wilderness experience offers us is a time to strip away what is cluttering our mere existence. So what is our wilderness today? The author of the book would say it could be some emotions we have, it could be a relationship, it could be time of life that we're in. But God met Hagar and Moses and Elijah, and he met others in the wilderness, and he's willing to meet you and I there. As we enter Lent, think about our particular wilderness and what that would look like. Amen. Our service continues on page 191. Dear friends in Christ, God is steadfast in love and infinite in mercy. He welcomes sinners and invites them to his table. Let us confess our sins, confident in God's forgiveness. Most merciful God,
we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed. By what we have done, and by what we have left undone, we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry that we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins. Confirm and strengthen you in all goodness and keep you in eternal life, through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Our offertory hymn is 380, verse 1, 3, 5, and 6. Let us pray. pray for peace. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For peace from on high and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
At this time, we pray for Ukraine having its first anniversary of the war that's been put upon them. Most holy God and Father, hear our prayers for all who strive for peace and all who fight for justice. Help us to today remember the cost of war to work for a better tomorrow. And as we commend to you lives lost in terror and conflict, bring us all in the end to the peace of your presence. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
We pray for the peace of the whole world and the welfare of the Holy Church of God and the unity of all. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For our bishops, remembering Archbishop David Edwards, and for all the clergy and people, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For Elizabeth, our queen, and for the Charles, our king, and the leaders of the nation, for all in authority, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the city of St. John and the surrounding city and communities, for those who live in them in faith, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For good weather and for abundant harvest for all to share, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For those who travel by land, water, air, for those who are sick and suffering, especially those that are on our hearts this morning, and those on our parish, pray with prayers. For prisoners and captives, and for the safety and health of salvation, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For our deliverance from all affliction, strife, and need, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the absolution and remission of our sins and offenses, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For all who have died, especially remembering those of our family that have gone on before us, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
And remembering all the saints, we commit ourselves to one another and our whole life to Christ our God.
To thee, O Lord.
Almighty God, who has given us grace at this time at one accord to make common supplications unto thee, and thus promise when two or three are gathered together in thy name, thou wilt hear their requests. Fulfill now, O Lord, the desires and petitions of thy servants as may be most expedient for them, granting us in this world knowledge of thy truth, and in the world to come, life everlasting. For thou, Father, art good and loving, and we glorify thee through thy Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, in the Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
We turn to Eucharistic prayer number 3, found on page 198. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
Above all in the Word made flesh, Jesus your Son. For in these last days you sent him to be incarnate from the Virgin Mary and to be the Savior and Redeemer of the world. In him you have delivered us from evil and made us worthy to stand before you. In him you have brought us out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, out of death into life. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, a death he freely accepted, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this in remembrance of me." Therefore, Father, according to his command,
we remember his death. We proclaim his resurrection. We await his coming in glory.
And we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son in his sacrifice, that we, made acceptable in him, may be sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, reconcile all things in Christ and make them new. And bring us to that city of light, where you dwell with your sons and daughters, through Jesus Christ our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, the author of our salvation, by whom and with whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory are yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
Turning to page 211. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, let thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Turning to page 212, we use fraction sentence number 3. Creator of all, you gave us golden fields of wheat, and many grains we have gathered and made into this one bread.
So many of your churches have gathered from the ends of the earth into your kingdom.
The gifts of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Jesus, thank you.
Thank you.
Serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.